the types of seismic sources in land surveying. Today, we are going to discuss and understand the theory of geophones. Of course, we have met geophone before, but now we are going a little bit more detailed about the type and the theory of geophones. Geophones can be defined as a device used to detect ground vibration, converting mechanical energy into electric pulses or signals. The electric pulses are then transferred into the seismograph for processing and recording. Generally, geophones are employing electromagnetic phenomena where a coil is suspended between the poles of a magnet, permanent magnet. Due to the suspension, when the particle attached to the geophone vibrates, we have a relative motion between the coil and magnet. When I have coil and I have magnet and the coil is moving, now I'm beginning to have electric signal in the coil. This signal is dependent in both direction and intensity or magnitude on the initiating displacement or movement. Thus, we convert the mechanical vibration into electric signal or pulse. The same like this mic. This mic convert mechanical sound vibration into electric pulse, and this electric pulse goes to the instrument for amplification, for recording, and so on. Here we have a small video about it. Yes. Now, this is the educational movie about the construction or the structure of the geophones. So, as you see, this is the heart or the important part of the geophone. It's composed, as you see, from housing, and inside this housing you have magnet, permanent magnet, and as you see, there is two coils. This cover two coils, and these two coils are applied. We are applying two coils in order to remove distortion. All are housed in the body of the geophone. Okay, here he show us the coil, the wires, the cover wires of the coil, and there is a spring. Now he demonstrates the spring. This spring is responsible for the relative movement. We have now relative movement between the coil and the permanent magnet. And what he show, this is a connection. These connections are used to connect or to take the electric signal to the seismograph or to the recording instrument.
Thanks for joining the Seismo guys.
So this how geophone is made, and this is the electromagnetic magnet used. This is also a diagram showing. Now, suppose this is the ground, And there are vibration beneath the geophone. The housing will move while the suspended coil, mass will be relatively stable, but the housing move relative to it. So due to this movement, electric current is produced. Now this is the shape of the geophone from outside. We can use the geophone without the spike. But why we are using spike? No.
The wave is from the ground, so.
No, but I can put it on the ground, but.
It's not suitable because we have the vertical motion, so we should put in a vertical.
No, the spike is used to increase the coupling between the geophone and the ground, but in some application, you may understand or you may experience after graduation, we can use geophones for example for surface wave measurements without the spike. Okay, sometimes we put the geophone in a duct and move with the duct if we are going to make a profile, long profile for surface wave analysis. Coupling. To firmly being firmly attached with the ground. Okay. Coupling. C. C O U P L I N G. Yes. Is it a bad word or? Yeah. Okay. Now we arrive to one of the important part of the geophone that's not illustrated so far, and maybe we didn't discuss before. This property is called damping. Now damping is an important part of seismometer or geophone. We can imagine geophone as a simple pendulum. Okay, suppose we have simple pendulum. This simple pendulum at rest, the mass is at equilibrium position. Okay, when you shift the mass away from its equilibrium position, the restore and then you leave it, the restoring force cause the mass to move into the equilibrium position. When it arrives at the equilibrium position, there are inertia kept in the mass that force the mass to move in the opposite direction until reaching the maximum place in the opposite direction and then returning back. We call swings or vibration. So the pendulum keeps vibrating. The same situation happened for the geophone. The geophone is some sort of a pendulum. When movement comes underneath this geophone, it will vibrate. So the first energy, the first wave form came, arrived, say direct wave, and then we have the geophone swing or vibrate, and then it will continue vibrating. Afterwards, after a certain time, another wave energy, seismic energy arrived, like say refracted or reflected energy. If the geophone is not ready or it's still vibrating, It will not record the new, the incoming seismic phase correctly. It will be contaminated with the train or with the tail of the previous vibration of the previous seismic energy. So what we are trying to do is to damp this seismometer, damp the geophone, so that it returns fast to its equilibrium position. Okay? This is the theory of damping. We want to make the vibration to attenuate rapidly so that the geophone is ready for the incoming, other coming seismic energy, or else my record will be in distorted version. This case can be illustrated like the shock absorber in the cars. Okay? This is a shock absorber. You think like myself when I bought a car about 12 or 14 years ago. I saw the spiral, the string, is the important part. The string is not the important part. The important part is here, inside the absorber. We have here, this is the piston, and this is the housing, and inside this housing there is oil. When the car is vibrated due to bump or something, the piston move downward, and then when it returns back upward, the oil attenuate its return, so that when the car have some sort of bump or something or shock, it will not continue vibration. It will arrive fast to its equilibrium position. And this is a small test for you if you are going to buy a car. If you want to know whether the suspension is good or not, you just, if you have some force, you go near the absorber, and then you push the car downward number of times and then leave it. If it continues to vibrate, so the absorption is not working properly. If it's stopped directly or after a small amount of time, so the absorption is okay. If the absorption is not present, when you drive your car and have a bump, and there is a lot of bump in the streets, you will continue to vibrate until you arrive your home. Okay? Please, if you have a question in an exam or test about damping, it's not needed to draw the shock absorber. It's for simplification and for imagination on how it's going on. I'm telling you that because a friend, my colleague working at in Saudi Arabia, and he was also making this example. And when he asked about damping, they sketch the shock absorber and leaving totally all what related to seismometer or geophones. Now, we have, this is the frequency response of a geophone with different damping level. So we have low damping and we have over damping. In all cases, all what we need is the thing called critical damping. It's that type of damping that give me the representation of the vibration of the shock itself and return back rapidly to its zero position. And this occurs for the critical one. And usually it's 0.707 damping. It's a ratio. Damping is a ratio. Here is an example of the damping. This one, the first one, is a clamped. Clamped mean the mass is clamped, mean it's not free to move. So there is no vibration. You see there is no vibration here. And B, there is overdamping. Overdamped, we have the amplitude is low and it returns to zero position at longer period. This one is preferred, which is the critical damping, which record or sense the vibration and then return rapidly to zero position, waiting for the forthcoming seismic energy. Now, for overdamped, you have this form. You have you do not totally remove or return to zero. You have overshoot here, and you the instrument itself is amplifying somehow the movement that arrive. So it's not also for overdamping. It's not also suitable because the movement of the coil may or of the mass may distort the shape of the produced or the shape of the arrived seismic signal. This last one is how we measure estimate the damping. As I told you, it's a ratio, so it's amplitude ratio here. This one is called DC offset, and it means we have offset from the zero position. So in DC offset, we need to remove this effect because it hides the way or tied the amplitude of the wave recorded. Of course, we have many instruments many methods for determining damping. There is mechanical methods, and there are also electric or electronic method for damping and controlling the behavior of the seismometer. Now we move to geophone interval. If you remember, it was one of our points that we are going to cover in our discussion about land seismic survey. Of course, I'm not going to cover all the topic because land seismic survey and the marine seismic survey are courses for themselves, but we are just having glimpse about the subjects. The geophone interval is an important factor as it represents the subsurface sampling in the seismic reflection experiment. So I am in geophone in the spread and laying our geophones, I am sampling the subsurface. So geophone interval must be taken in the sense that the structure I'm looking for, the dimension of the structure I'm looking for, be represented by the geophone interval. For example, if I'm having a small scale structure, thus I need to have small geophone interval. If my intention is to image large scale structure, so the geophone intervals may be larger. And as we discussed yesterday, our work is to conduct our analysis, our imaging, seismic imaging experiment, with the little or with the less cost. Our work is based on cost effective. Okay, not always we have a lot of money to spend on seismic experiment or on any other experiment. So as a geophysicist, we are looking for reducing cost. So if I'm not looking for very small features, it's nonsense to go for very small geophone interval. Okay? So here, the choice of geophone interval or separation is not a free choice. Why? Because I am also controlled by the lens of the array. Because the lens of the array also controls the depths of penetration. So if you are going to reduce the geophone interval, you are also reducing the length of the geophone of the array, which in turn reduce the depth of penetration. The depth of penetration, the penetration depth. We have seen such diagram before. This is a single channel diagram. I have only one source and one receiver, and the reflection point is a midway between the source and the receiver. This is a multi-channel where I have the source in the middle and the receivers are spread on both sides. This for 2D, but for 3D we may spread the geophones in all directions. And of course, this point in the subsurface is a midpoint or common depth point or any other terminology. This is a reflection point between the source and receiver. The area from here to here is called subsurface coverage. As you see, the subsurface coverage is less than the surface distribution of source and geophones. This travel time distance curve represent the type of energy and phases that we expect to observe in raw seismic reflection or in any seismic experiment. And this will help you in your assignment. One of the points of the assignment is to define the phases you see in the record. So here we have the direct waves, the waves that move directly from the source to the geophones. And then we have the refracted arrival, which becomes the first arrivals after some distance called X cross or crossover distance. And then we have the air wave, the source, whether hammer or dynamite or any other, it produces sound waves. Sound waves moves in all direction and also affect, as a pressure wave, affect the geophone and being recorded. And so this is called air wave. The velocity of wave is 3, 4, 6 meter per second. Okay? And sometimes it's called the 3, 4, 6 meter per second. Sometimes they call it Mach. Okay, this is which is the velocity of sound. So for aeroplanes that move faster than the sound, we expect to have its velocity is 1 plus matter. The parabola here is a reflection from Bedrock that we are going.
One plus
mech, yeah, means more than one mech.
Mech.
M-A-C-H, mech. Okay? The velocity of sound. Okay? And now the last one that sometimes we use it for shear wave detection is called the surface waves or ground roll. And the surface waves appears with high amplitude on the seismic section. So the ground roll, we need to remove its effect, and maybe we are going to see this in the next half of the semester, how to remove the effect of ground roll. Because the removal of ground roll, we have two main processes. One of these processes is in acquisition itself. Sometimes the geophone position is not only one or single geophone. The position or the site, we may have multiple geophones array in each site. The distribution of the geophone is used to destructively interfere the ground roll, and then we can sum or stack these geophones to remove the effect of ground roll. In seismic reflection, we do not, unlike seismic refraction, you are experienced with seismic refraction, but unlike seismic refraction, we are not shooting at single place and recording at the same place and so on. No, we have the source and the receiver moving along the array, along the profile I'm having. And in this is a spread one, offset, some distance, maybe half the geophone interval, and then, and so on. Thus, this represents the covered area by the offset. Only small part of this offset here will yield the maximum fall. It will be covered by all shooting. Okay? For example, if I'm having 12, 24 shooting and moving half geophone interval, I only have small area here where the common depth point or common midpoint in this area have 24 traces. Before this area, I have less traces. After this area, I have also less traces. Okay? You seem not understanding this, not imagining. Can. Okay.
Listen, just now you said the geophone is moving, is it?
The geophone, both the source and geophone is moving.
Oh.
Yes.
Also for lens away. This is for lens away, isn't it?
This?
This is for lens away, isn't it? Lens away.
Lens?
Lens away.
Land survey, and also in the for marine survey. The same holds true for marine survey.
Is okay. Just now the geophone we need to couple to the
surface,
isn't it?
So
how does the
geophone
can move along with the source?
Oh. Okay. This is a good question. First, I put the geophones on the ground, firmly coupled to the ground. Okay? Suppose I will give an example of having only five geophones. Okay? So all these geophones are attached to the recording and the control unit. So I am ordering the control unit to record data from these five geophones. And the shot is here. Then I will move my shot, say, to here, and then I will order the recorder, the control, to record from the next G phones, moving, shifting only one G phone, and so on. Okay? This type is called roll along. Roll along. Okay? So I'm doing this. Of course, it will be time consuming to put 24 geophones and then to detach the geophones and move one spacing and so on. But sometimes, if we don't have geophones other than this, we will take geophone from this place, from the first one, and move to the last and move our survey unit, so on. But this is time consuming and very difficult to carry out. We need to have more geophones to apply roll along experiment. Of course, for marine survey, we have the vessel and the cable is in back of the vessel, and there is buoy that keep the cable straight and also define the place with GPS so that we fire and record the location with GPS and we record seismic energy while the vessel is moving. When we come to marine, inshallah, after the break, the semester break, we will see a movie about how the marine movie, yes, about how marine surveys is carried out. Okay, now we have this table that reduce the noise, please. Okay, now we have some comparison on the choice of the parameters of land survey. We have petroleum and engineering application. Of course, you can use reflection also for engineering application. So for explosive seismic sources, for petroleum exploration, the mass of the dynamite is between 10 to 25 kilometers or more in a distributed pattern in deep holes. Distributed pattern in deep holes. Excuse me? I'm sorry. Of course, it's a very fatal mistake. Okay, sorry. Kilograms. From 10 to 25 kilograms. Distributed in a pattern, in a deep hole patterns. In engineering, it's 20 to 50 grams in single shot. And also we can use hammer or wet drop in our experiment. So the remarks, we are using this type of pattern to increase frequency content. As yesterday, we understand that we having smaller charge produce high frequency content. So instead of firing all the charge in one hole, we distribute the hole, the charge on number of holes and fire to get the to increase the frequency content. For mechanical seismic sources, we can use 1 to 7 vibrators, 5 to 15,000 kilogram peak force. For frequency or frequency sweeps from 10 to 100 hertz. For engineering, we can use only hammer and the blades and the guns. For geophones, we use arrays of 12 to 48 geophones with fundamental frequency between 24 and 40 hertz, the spacing between 3 and 20 meters. For engineering, we have single or 3 to 5 geophones. The fundamental frequency is 50 to 100 hertz because I'm here in engineering, I am looking for high resolution at shallow depths. Frequency, fundamental frequency, and the spacing is between 1 and 3 meters, but of course I can use longer depending on the objective of my experiment. Recorders, there is an instantaneous floating point from 48 channel to 1000 channel. The common recorder for engineering is 24 to 96 channel, and this of course for cost effective. The analog filter, it's from here from 10 to 110 hertz, and for engineering it's from 100 to 500 hertz, and this to increase frequency content. Sample interval, it's from 1 to 2 milliseconds here, while it's 1/4 to 1/8 millisecond. Why? Because in engineering we are using higher frequency than the petroleum exploration. Now we have some remarks. Field data acquisition parameters are highly site specific. So the parameters we have so far is subject to change according to the site, according to the experiment itself, what you are looking for. Up to a full day of testing with a knowledgeable consultant experienced in shallow seismic work may be required. So usually before going to conduct the main experiment, I usually first go for testing. Test the site, look at the condition, the environment of the site, and then plan the like geophone intervals, spread lengths, the sample rate, and so on. But this is not always feasible. Why? Because sometimes, like here, we have limited budget, so I cannot go first exploitation or for sightseeing and then return back to conduct. It will cost a lot, so it's not always feasible. But for the ideal practice, you should first go examine the area and examine the environment and do a test survey before you conduct the survey itself. The objective of this test is identifiable, demonstrable reflections on the raw records. If arrivals consistent with reflections from the zone of interest cannot be seen, the chance that processing will cover useful data are slim. So this is a test. I'm having objective, I want to see something, and then I see the raw data. So if it's not okay, I will change my parameter. One useful testing technique is a walk-away noise test. Was walk-away noise test. A closely spaced set of receiver is set out with geophone interval equal to 1% or 2% of the depth of interest. often as little as 30 or 60 centimeters for engineering application. So this is test, very, very narrow, and I'm trying to get information, the best information about the situation I'm looking for. By firing shots at different distances from this spread, a well-sampled long offset spread can be generated, and variables can include geophone arrays, shot patterns, high and low cut filters, and AGC window, among others. These are the main values we are looking for. This movie, it's from geometrics, and it represents how the experiment is carried out. You can see it because the time is up. You can see it on blend space. And this is how the 3D stack may look like. We may have the source in the middle and the geophones distributed around this source. The circle now here represent the stack, the 3D stack, or the common midpoint stack or gathering for 3D analysis. This figure you have seen before, this is the matrix, the geophone matrix, the shot geophone matrix for 2D. Here we have the source coordinates, and here we have the receiver coordinates. This line represents the common midpoint, and this one represents the common offset. This is another matrix, but this matrix is representing the 3D survey matrix. Here also, the shot is in the column direction of the matrix, and the receivers are in the row direction of the matrix. Now we have 6 points that must be taken into consideration when designing the survey. We have to start the design with a crossed array geometry. We may have two types of array geometry, one orthogonal, which is perpendicular, not vertical, because if we are dealing with map views, there is no vertical. It's orthogonal, perpendicular to each other lines. And then sampling along the receiver and the source line, find sample within 3D single fold subsets. We call each one of this we call this fold. So not to be confused with the geologic terminology of folding. Okay, so this fold means time, like one time, two times, three times, okay, like lagi in Bahasa, okay. So this is satu lagi, dua lagi, tiga lagi, and so on. Okay. Receiver and source line intervals, which is coarse sampling, should be based on the minimum offset requirements of the shallowest reflector and the degree of complexity of the near surface analysis. Maximum inline and the cross line offset shall be determined by the maximum reflection angles required for the deepest target. The minimum trace density or fold will be a result of the above criteria. Higher fold, if desired, should be obtained only by reducing source or receiver lines interval. And finally, the field execution method shall be determined based on the operational efficiency and the available equipment. This is a scheme. This is a schematic view of the 6 points listed in the previous slide. Thank you, and see you the week after, and I hope you have a pleasant semester break.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.